edges and know how things work on the inside. The one and only Danielle Smith. Share your opinion now. Call or text 403-974-8255. Danielle Smith on 770 CHQR.
Brought to you by the Popowich Carmeli Advisory Group, CIBC Wood Gundy.
All right, and we're off. You guys have heard from me about why I support this plan. You've also heard from Amashi Lander about why he doesn't support this plan. We have heard pretty well a mix. It's sort of interesting to me that some of my staunch conservatives, like Eric and Jason, are behind this deal, whereas I don't think they were behind the Olympics deal. So this is not the kind of issue that cuts very clearly down ideological lines. And I understand it's complicated talking about this at a time when they have to make cuts to their operational budget. I get all of that. But for me, and I've written a column on this for tomorrow, you will see, when I look at the deal that they had before versus this one, hands down, it's a better deal. And when I look at the promise of what it can bring to the area, hands down, it makes more sense than to go with the status quo. But you don't need to hear from me. You need to hear from the person who is going to be behind the deal, seeing it through all the way to the bitter end. He said it was the longest, what'd you call it? The longest race to get to the starting line of any project. And now they're at the starting line. If you've got questions, 403-974-8255. For my cast, Ken King. He's the Vice Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Calgary Sports and Entertainment Corporation. Thank you so much for joining me, Mr. King.
Thank you for the invitation. I'm thrilled to be here.
Okay, I have to tell you, when I was talking with Amashi Lander on Monday, I was thinking this is going to be a terrible deal if all they're going to try to sell me on is the incremental increase in property tax revenue that comes from building the center. But that's not what it is. It's a lot more than that.
Well, if you look at the infographic, and I think most people have seen it, there's a number of pools of funds. But here's the odd part of this. We needed to release the economic influence and economic impact. Moishe and Trevor Toombs and some of the academics, and here's what I don't really understand about their analysis is okay. I mean, Trevor Toombs sat in my office a few months ago, and I said, so, Trevor, do you not like arenas or you don't like hockey? What's the issue? He said, no, not at all. He said, and I quote, he said, I actually think this could be a really good idea. Now, he doesn't like the foundation basis upon which the economics are written here. They are what they are. So my question to he and Moishe too is, what do you want? What would you like? How would you like to see us characterize this? We're not characterizing this to sell it to anybody. We have a very complicated agreement between four parties that we managed to put together, and we thought we should just display what was happening there. This is not a sales pitch. It's not sales, and I'm not here to sell it. There are people, perhaps Moishe included, who just don't like, philosophically don't like the idea, period. And I respect that. And their Canadian Taxpayers Federation don't like it. Canadian Taxpayers Federation and some of the others, they don't want to delay this. They want to have it not happen. So that's fine. Just declare your position and tell everyone what your position is. But don't hide behind, well, I don't like the economics. If you just don't philosophically believe this is the right thing to do, just say so.
Because they'll never be convinced.
Let me tell you two
of the arguments that I think, first, the economists would make, and then second, that the taxpayers might make. First, the argument would be that this $138.7 million of incremental Rivers District property tax that go into making the overall benefit $400 million, that's a bit of an exaggeration, because that's money that would come anyway with an increase in development in that area, and it's not accurate to credit that incremental increase with the arena deal.
I don't necessarily agree with that. I think, well, let's look at it this way. Actually, I was on the Stampede committee that assembled that land 25 years ago. Nothing has happened there. And the reason that nothing has happened there is partly because everybody wants to know what's going on with the arena before anybody pulls any triggers of any kind. Stampede had 60, 70% leases on 4th Street, which they decided not to execute because one of the big questions was, what's going on with the Flames? What's going on with the arena? So it really put a stall on it. We tried. We weren't stalling it. We were ready to go 10 years ago. And by the way, today is 5 years from now. Let's be clear about that. CMLC believes that we will, and I know these are cliche words, that we will be a catalyst for development there. Our question is really the same as your question. We said to them, well, prove to us, or at least tell us, give us some confidence that if we move 200 yards to the north, that something's going to happen here. We don't need to sit in a wasteland now and a wasteland later. They laid out their vision, they laid out their plans, and they said, and you guys are really quite critical to it. So all of it, part of it, I don't know, but I know this. They believe that we are really critical to this, which is why they invited us back to discussions.
Okay. Let me then play the devil's advocate. I think the city is terrible at developing entertainment areas. When I look at the wasteland that surrounds the current Saddle Dome or the planetarium or the music center or the library or the art center, they basically have one restaurant and one coffee shop. It's not a place where you would go early and you'd sit on a patio and you'd people watch and you'd enjoy it. And then after a game, you'd go back and you'd buy beer and wings and sit with your friends. It's basically take the LRT in or find a parking spot, watch the game, and then leave. And why would this be any different? And the city has demonstrated that they have zero talent at being able to develop vibrant, interesting community areas. Why would this be different?
I'm not sure that's fair to the city. I'm not here to be an apologist for the city. But I'm not sure that's fair. What we have is no accumulation, no aggregation of assets here. The Rivers District aggregates the library. It aggregates the Bell Center, the new BMO Convention Center, and us. That's really starting to be what you're talking about here, which is critical mass. When you get that critical mass, and whether they're coming to any one of those four or any other East Village or Stampede or Event Center, that's what creates the development, and that's what happens. So there hasn't been a place. When they talked us off the wall from West Village, they said, no, you're just going to split the pie here. You're going to build stuff over in West Village. We're going to build stuff in East Village here, and we're going to have what you said, which is not there. Now, at the time, we were pretty disappointed. We thought, we can build something special over there. But to their credit, they were very determined and said, we can make something very important for our city here, and it's going to take all the parties. Don't forget the convention center. It's going to be a very big draw for a lot of people and a lot of visitors.
Okay, if there aren't more than 10 interesting places to sit and eat and drink and have coffee, then I'm going to call it a failure.
You know what? I'll call it a failure too, and I'll call foul, because that's not what we've been promised in terms of what should happen in the area.
Okay, paint us a vision then. What if you could look at a place that has done this really well, where they've got an entertainment district that complements what you're doing, what they're doing at an arena? What should we be looking at for inspiration?
You could look at Nashville. You could look at the Staples Center and LA Live. You could look at Columbus. You could look at Minnesota. And Columbus and Minnesota maybe are, we're not Los Angeles. I get that. And we're not New York. But they're kind of similar sized cities. And they built beautiful areas. And the event center, the arenas in those areas were a critical and tactical part of doing that. So there's lots of precedent for it. Again, the economist says, well, that never happens. Well, it does happen, actually.
Okay.
Have a look around.
Okay, I will look at those, I promise you. Let's then talk about another beef that our listeners have, is that they look at you, and this is the term that they use. It's you've got millionaire players and billionaire owners. Why can't they pay the $550 million shot 100% themselves? Why do Calgary taxpayers have to kick in?
So here's the question. Why wouldn't we, if that were feasible? Why wouldn't we? Why would we expose ourselves to this? I respect your listeners. I honestly do. I have a family. I have friends. They're what's going on here. If we could have done that in any viable way, that's exactly what we've done. The fact that they're writing a check in this day and age for $275 million for a building, which the city will own, which will have residual value, contrary to what the economists might say, after 35 years, and I hope we're in it 35 and 45 and 55 years from now. So our guys looked at it and said, what's reasonable? What could we possibly do? And they're making a massive commitment to Calgary and this area. Wasn't their first choice. But I'm really proud of them. I have no demur. And I think the last time around they were pilloried and they're rich guys. I think their most cardinal sin is that they're successful. And I think that permits them to take a relatively marginal hockey market and commit to it for the past 40 years and continue to commit for it for the next 40 years.
You know,
I think that's really laudable on their part. And to join with the city, look at Edmonton and look at Quebec, look at Winnipeg, look at cities our size. Look at Minnesota and Columbus that are our size. These are tough, tough markets. I know everybody thinks that we're full all the time and everything is wonderful. We have to really, really work hard to make any sort of a business case at all. This isn't the best business case for us to have, but it's the one that we're prepared to take.
Let me see if you can argue it another way, because what I have argued with listeners who disagree with me is that it's not that the Flames are getting 100% of the benefit and 100% of the activities are just Flames. There's a portion that is concerts. In fact, sorry to tell you, I've been to more concerts at the Saddle Dome than I have the Flames games. But there's major events. I think Obama spoke there. There are other sporting activities that take place. What is the rough split of how much you guys use it versus how many other events take place there?
Well, first off, we manage it all, okay? So there's a great misnomer that when Garth Brooks comes to town and there's millions of dollars in ticket sales, well, there is. That's not our money. We rent the building to him. And it's often at a risk, not to Garth Brooks. He's not much of a risk. But there are others that we sometimes generate no rent from. We'll sell some food and beverage and that type of thing, and that's sort of sustaining. So we manage the entire building for all of that. There's We Day, there's 14 days of Stampede, and we turn the building over to them. That does not accrue to our benefit. We're happy to do that. That's an old clause. That's a new clause in the new agreement that will continue. We did that when we did not have $275 million invested, and we're doing it now that we do have $275 million. We're citizens, too. And good citizens at that.
I guess the way I look at it is, if the Flames left, we'd still have Garth Brooks coming to town, and we'd still have the Stampede. There'd still be a public use for that building, even if the Flames group wasn't managing it anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm not talking about the Flames left, ever. That's why I've spent the last 10 years of my life on this situation here. The fact of the matter is, nobody's ever talked about the implications of us not doing this. I guess we'll stay in Saddle Dome. We'll continue to operate the way we have been operating as best we possibly can. And I don't know, 5 years from now or 4 years from now or 10 years from now, somebody will want to build the building and they'll pay for it all. And now they leveraged their money on the BMO Center. They're leveraging their money here. And not having to do what most cities do, like Edmonton and other cities, it's a prerequisite to share. Now, if you don't want to have it, then we shouldn't do it. The councillors are well briefed. They've got all of the information. They've got a big decision to make, and I've not phoned one of them. I'm not lobbying anybody. This has to stand on its merit. It has to stand on its merit with the public. And they have to depend on their counselors to make decisions, and the counselors will.
Okay, I've been monitoring and asking questions based on what you guys are texting in, so keep them coming. 403-974-8255. We'll continue our conversation with Ken King right after this on 770 CHQR. All right, still some people who are a little unconvinced. So Diane has a question, and many of my listeners do as well, about the football stadium. I think most people think that the beauty of the West Village proposal was that you had a solution for the Stamps, too. Now we don't have a solution for the Stamps, and we don't have a field house.
No, we don't. It's been orphaned, and that's really nobody's fault. You can't build a football stadium. I guess you can in Regina. For $300 million for 10 football games. But it's highly impractical. Unless you can get some synergy, unless you can combine it with a field house or something like that, it's just not practical. I hope when they're looking at the field house, which is on deck, that they'll at least consider an option for McMahon Stadium. But the notion of building a new football stadium, I think, is not highly likely.
Okay, I've got Les saying, here's the problem. I can't afford to go to a game now, and I'm going to have to pay $13 for a hot dog and $9.50 for a bottle of water. If taxpayers are kicking in, where's the accessibility for Calgarians?
Well, I don't know what we would have to charge for a bottle of water or a beer or popcorn under other circumstances, but I don't think it's really fair to predict what our prices are going to be. We have to cleave to the market, whatever the market is, and we're pretty fair. We have our happy hour, and we do it to reward people who come early, because we simply need to filter in the building so everybody doesn't come at the same time.
Can you describe what that is? Because Pat was just saying, I love your happy hour. What is your happy hour pricing?
Basically, it's $5 beer and or a pop and a $5 burger, designed to get people to filter into the building on an even flow basis. We have a lot of congestion, as you know, if you've ever been or ever decide to come. And
I went to the Duran Duran concert in 2017, yeah. So I'll go to Duran Duran when they come back again.
So we have value tickets, we've got our press level tickets, we've got value opportunities throughout the building. We cannot afford to simply put it to people in the building we have or in a new building. It's just not practical. The market dictates what can and should happen, and fairness dictates what can and should happen. If we were greedy people, we wouldn't be doing this deal.
So you may still have the happy hour pricing then, for the same reason that you want to just control the flow. Okay, Les, there's your answer. You just have to go early. I've got another person here saying Calgary's hurting right now, and the team is sitting rich. So why is it that Calgarians have to pay?
So the team is not sitting rich. I'm not sure by definition what that actually means. Calgary's hurting because our economy got absolutely slapped in the shoulder blades for lots of different reasons. And when that happens, you need to, the economists don't like the word stimulus, but you need to do things. You need to be forward and you need to be progressive. The other part of this question is, we're making cuts, operational cuts and that type of thing. If this deal did not happen, if they voted down on Tuesday, they're not changing the operational cuts. Nothing changes there. You don't spend your capital dollars to subsidize your operating dollars, because what happens is that you're commingling the funds, and pretty soon there's no capital dollars for opportunity, and you still got a problem with your operating. They'll get their fiscal house in order. They have to. They have no choice. This will not influence that, other than possibly in a positive way.
Okay. One of the things that I do like about the new deal is the facility fee. If I understand it, maybe you can explain it. Is there a facility fee that's a lump sum payment in addition to a 2% ticket tax, or are they one and the same?
No, they're one and the same, and it's capped for the first term, and then it's wide open after that for 35 years. Hence the calculation of $155 million.
So $155 million might turn out to be low, because as ticket prices go up, as events go up, as we're able to attract more big acts, it may be that there's an upside to that.
Yeah, for sure.
Why didn't they have that in the deal before?
Well, they did, actually. They had considerably more facility fees, so much more that we didn't think we could handle it. And people have also, I think erringly so, compared this deal to the other deal. There was no other deal. City couldn't come to our arrangement. We couldn't come to theirs. Fair deal. That's fair. Now we can, and it's really creative. And thanks to a guy named Barry Monroe and Jeff Davison, Ward Sutherland, and the mayor and others, who said, "Look, we need to do this. We need to figure out a way to make a deal that works. It's complicated. It's very, very fair." I also think there's a, and I shouldn't probably say this, but sometimes I think people think just because we agreed to it, that must mean it's in our favor. What it is, it's in everyone's favor, more particularly as people of Calgary. We cannot swoop in and force anybody to do anything. The councillors are going to make a pretty clear-eyed decision on Tuesday. And we're going to live and abide by that.
I've got somebody asking, you're only a few yards away from the Saddle Dome, which flooded, caused a major renovation to be needed. What are they doing about flooding so that doesn't happen in the new facility?
Well, there's a flood mitigation plan. There's a global flood mitigation plan or provincial, but also that's part of our geotechnical work in terms of understanding that particular area. And we may have to go not as deep as we would like to. We're certainly not going to go as deep as the Saddle Dome is. So there may be some more vertical as a consequence of that. But flood mitigation is a key part. And that area is not as susceptible believe it or not, as it is down the road. But you're asking all the really good questions, including, well, what about this development? What about flood mitigation? They were the same questions we asked.
Okay, what about this last piece? I should have asked you it earlier. There, you've got an option to buy land worth $100 million in the surrounding area. Why was that important? And are you going to exercise it? And what are you going to do with it?
Well, first off, I don't know if we're going to exercise it or not, because that stands separately. CMLC, the city, wants that area to be developed. We want it to be developed. If we can find clients and if we can find a development partner, we'd like to participate in that, and we will. Again, no smoking guns there. It's good for everybody if we build a hotel or whatever it might be. All we have is a fair market value option to spend more money to make the area better.
Okay, last question. If you get a new rink, can you guarantee that we're going to get a Stanley Cup?
Sure. yes, but no.
All right, that was Ken King, Vice Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Calgary Sports and Entertainment Corporation, hopefully answering some of your questions. Give me your thoughts, 403-974-8255. We will be right back on 770 CHQR.